This is a National Arts Center podcast. Find more great NAC podcasts on the performing arts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free.
My guest today is Alexander Shelley, music director-designate of the NAC Orchestra, who is in town this week to conduct the orchestra in works by Nicolai, Korngold, and Mendelssohn. He's also preparing for his first full season as music director and is in the process of finalizing the repertoire for next season, a season we're all looking forward to. Alexander, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you.
And by the way, this is your third visit, and you've just broken the record for guest appearances on the podcast.
Oh, what an honor. What an honor. Well, it's lovely to see you again.
Now, next season holds a lot of promise. We're all very excited about it. Could you run us through the salient points?
Sure, I'd be happy to do that. I think there were a few basic ideas that I wanted to build on. The first was the principle of putting something new on every program. And when I say new, I mean a work that the orchestra hasn't played before. Now, this could be from the Renaissance, from the Baroque period, the Classical period, the Romantic period. It could also be something that we've commissioned that's a new work. But I find the idea of exploring new music, music which we haven't played before together, which the orchestra has never done, the audience won't have heard here from the NAC Orchestra, is very exciting because alongside the glorious works of the core repertoire, which we all know and love and will continue to celebrate together, there's also a wealth of very, very beautiful pieces and very important pieces that it's nice to get to know. So that's one of the first building blocks. On every program in the season, the orchestra and the audience will experience something new, something that they haven't heard before collectively. Now, that leads on a little bit to my belief that in order to engage as fully as possible with music from earlier times, it's also useful to engage, or at least to think about how one engages with music written now. I also believe it happens to be part of the mandate of an institution like this, a national institution, to offer a forum to creative artists to say, you know, we're here for you, let's work together, let's explore what it means to create art, music, in the 21st century and have a forum for that exploration. So there will be, in my concerts, four or five world premieres of Canadian composers, which will all culminate in a very exciting concert called Dear Life. I'll come back to that a little bit later, maybe. And the third part, maybe, of how I've conceived the season from the point of view of my concerts is that each of the programs has a narrative. Each of the programs have three, four, five works which, in my mind, belong together, in which, in my mind, have strong associations with one another, which, in my mind, open a dialogue. It's one of the most fascinating things about any art form, and in fact, most things in life, be it, you know, sciences, the arts, literature, but they open doors. You know, they're not just the thing in themselves. They open doors to other walks of life and other areas, and even if it's just areas of thought or feeling, those doors are always there. So there will be a narrative to each concert, and that's a narrative that I will also endeavor to transmit to the audience before they come to the concert. So we're looking at ways in the months beforehand, when you go onto our website, when you engage with the orchestra in any form of media, to also be given an introduction as to why these programs are being put together, because I think that's very interesting for audiences.
It is, absolutely. Can you be a bit more specific? Last time we spoke, we talked about the links between literature and music. For instance, there's one concert
early in the season, or a series of concerts involving music of the 1920s and 1930s, all those isms.
Absolutely.
Modernism, expressionism, communism, fascism.
Yeah.
Could you address some of those points?
Well, the season kicks off, and just a couple of weeks into it, in October of 2015, we're going to have a festival. And one of the first periods of time that I was drawn to when discussing what we might take as the subject for our festival was the extraordinary blossoming of music after the First World War. There were periods before then, of course, when there were also huge changes in what happened in music. But if you look at the 20s, which people, you know, like to refer to as the Roaring 20s, there was a lot happening there that wasn't roaring. You know, there was a lot of also intellectualism. There was a lot of everything happening. There was a lot of roaring, too, and we'll celebrate that. But we've put together five programs which look at five distinct things that were happening. If let's say you were to be transported back in time to 1920 or 21 or 25 or 1918, what would have been the context of music then? What was happening in other art forms? What was happening in politics? What was happening in the sciences and philosophy to give a context to these pieces? Because you have, within 10 years, and sometimes concurrently, music written as different as An American in Paris, or Sibelius's Fifth Symphony, or Elgar's Cello Concerto, or Mio's Le Boeuf sur le Toit, or the Bolero by Ravel, or Stravinsky's Little Suites for orchestra, or Prokofiev's Third Piano Concerto. Then you have Charlie Chaplin writing music for his own films, and so on and so forth. And we frankly could have been put together 15 programs or 20 programs looking at this extraordinary period. But we've put together five, which I think will be a very interesting narrative for the audiences, beginning with the very end of the war, so 1918, and four works which are rooted in different ways, some of them more explicit, some of them less explicit, in nationalism. So at the center of the program are two works, Elgar's Cello Concerto and Sibelius's Fifth Symphony. Elgar's Cello Concerto, of course, a much loved work of the concerto repertoire with deep roots in the Romantic period and the Romantic way of expressing oneself. One hears, they may be apocryphal, but, you know, stories of him hearing the sounds of cannons echoing across the channel when he was writing this. But it's a form of, also to the Romantic period, I find a form of swan song. It's one of the last great works of that canon. And Sibelius's Fifth Symphony is very different. Sibelius was one of those composers who had an utterly distinctive voice, a bit like Berlioz, I find. When I come to analyze and work on the music of Sibelius, I have to sort of reset my mode of thinking. The way he writes phrases, the way he conceives of structure is sometimes disturbingly different to what was happening. And yet at the same time, he is deeply associated with Finland. You know, he's a national composer, and he was also, for me, someone who represented that idea of nation state. You know, I'm sure he wouldn't have explicitly, and I don't want to say anything to his politics, but as an icon, he very much belongs to, you know, that country. And then we have around it some dances by Janáček and some dances by Bartók, which celebrate these little states around Europe, which were just finding themselves in a state of disarray, in a sense. You know, the lines had been redrawn in Europe almost completely. But that first program sort of says, here's where we are. End of Romanticism, nation states experiencing a change, and the relationship to folk music and to a national school of music maybe starting to break down. And then we move through the festival into an exploration of, for example, what these great Russians were doing. So the next program, we look at Prokofiev and Stravinsky. And, you know, two men who were in France at the time, who went different directions with their music later in life, but who are two very important voices in the development of the 20th century, and who, of course, contrast utterly with in the sound of the music and the techniques they use to create that sound from, you know, Elgar and Sibelius, who you've heard in the program before. I mean, it's an astonishing juxtaposition. Just for example, you know, pop music at any given time, you never had that kind of difference, that the two forms of pop music would sound so utterly different. You know, rock and roll broadly from Europe across to the States or to the Far East, it was broadly the same sound and so on. Mm-hmm. Then I wanted to, you know, at the end of the festival, celebrate two amazing composers who are utterly accessible for very different reasons, but do have a relationship with one another, Ravel and Gershwin. I find it fascinating in the context of this blossoming, this internationalism in music, and this is maybe the root of this. For the first time, there was an almost unencumbered exchange of sound from east to west. You know, people could experience each other because of how easy it had become to travel, or much easier than it had been before. Sound could be, you know, transported from one place to another on recordings. And suddenly there was this influence happening all over the place. And it's funny, we think of a Ravel as being a deeply French composer, like Sibelius was a deeply Finnish composer. And yet he includes in his music jazz, you know? It's his form of using jazz, but he uses jazz. And he was, of course, earlier in his life affected by the sounds, you know, as other French composers, of gamelan and stuff in the Great Exhibition. But these influences were very important and make the music of that period suddenly very different. It's truly international music. The same way that Gershwin is in our minds and exists in the zeitgeist back then as a jazz composer, but he was deeply influenced by classical music and very interested by it, as was Cole Porter, who will also be celebrated on our programs, but that's in a slightly different one. I'll get to that in a second. Anyway, the final program we have, you know, four seminal works, in a sense, one each by Ravel and Gershwin, cornerstones being, at the end, An American in Paris, you know, and hence the sort of Gershwin connection with France. At the beginning, Bolero, the apotheosis of dance, like several other pieces have been called, but an incredible study in nothingness. You know, talk about taking form out of things. It's just a sort of, it just goes. It's like a worm that never ends, you know, with these wonderful solos from the orchestra. And then in between, a great friend of mine is coming, Kirill Gerstein, who's one of the finest classical composers of our, pianists of our day, and also an extraordinarily good jazz pianist. He actually studied jazz first at Berkeley. And he'll play Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, but he'll also play Ravel's Concerto for the Left Hand. So we see a coming together of these two worlds that have always been very related to one another, jazz and classical music. And finally, to talk about the last two programs, I mentioned Cole Porter. I wanted to take a program where we looked at the most divergent arms of the influence of classical music. Cole Porter writing for musicals and musical theater, songs that to this day people know and appreciate. And at the same time, you had a search in Germany and Austria going on for the continuation of the symphonic line. This question, right, where through Mahler have we got to? Schoenberg and his students saying, how can we continue this line? And I've taken two symphonies, very short pieces, which I happen to think are incredibly beautiful as well. Webern's symphony, which is only 10 minutes long, and it's for a little sort of chamber orchestra. And then Heise Ansler's little symphony, as it's called, which is maybe 12 minutes long, and also for a slightly reduced orchestra. To show this line of intellectual thought continuing, you know, where does the symphony go from now? Where does intellectual music go from now? And ironically, it's actually very intimate music to listen to in a concert hall. I'm looking forward to hearing people's reaction to it and how they find it. Those will be juxtaposed with songs by Cole Porter, the other extreme. And then I've allowed myself to have a bit of fun, which was Mio, Darius Mio, and Ibert, another French composer, wrote two pieces which straddle both worlds. They're kind of tongue-in-cheek. Le Boeuf sur le Toit by Mio, which starts off with a kind of samba sound and then goes off into lots of different sound worlds. And then Ibert's Divertissement, where he sort of makes fun of both of these worlds, the self-aware earnestness of intellectualism in Germany and then the sort of gaudiness of jazz, you know, the a satirical work, but again, really fun to listen to. That's that program. So that's a sort of intense analysis of these juxtapositions. And then finally, the what will be the fourth program chronologically, I believe, will be a performance of City Lights. Charlie Chaplin will show the film, and we'll play the score live underneath it, which I've never done before. I'm very excited to see how it works, whether I can do it. Maybe I'll...
It's lots of fun. Just follow the orchestra.
Exactly. I'll just follow you guys, yeah. So that's the second half of that concert. And it makes the... Charlie Chaplin was an incredible character. His life, as with many of the people that we're talking about, bridged the most extraordinary period of history. You know, when he was born, people were still driving around in carriages. When he died, we landed a man on the moon. It's really quite incredible. And his life, and in a sense, I think his degrees of happiness and success also mirrored these changes. He began in black and white and no word, just music. And then he went into talkies and then into, you know, color. And he who he was as a person, who his main character was, also changed with those years and became more or less current. Anyway, it's a great score, fantastic music. And before that, in the first half of that concert, we'll look at a composer whose sound I'm sure was influential on Chaplin. I don't know, but listening to Chaplin's music, it sounds like that sound world was influential on him, which is Kurt Weill, and we'll do the suite from Three Penny Opera. So I'm really excited about this festival because it's all music that I find beautiful. It's all music which is accessible, but it's also music which is very meaningful and celebrates a period in our human history of creation which is really quite extraordinary, and I think opens doors to a lot of very interesting conversations about now, also what it means to be American or French or Canadian or English. You know, what role does nationalism have in the arts, in politics, in identity, and how much are we the product of a very international world? You know, and how art has expressed this, how art has reflected it. You know, these are fantastic conversations that I look forward to engaging in with our audience.
One thing that occurs to me about the period that you're talking about, you mentioned Bartok, for instance, his arrangements and his actually subsumation, if you like, of folk material into his work. Mm. How would you address the concept of the new forms? For instance, in art in the 20s, before then even, we have Cubism, Impressionism, different ways of looking at basically the same material.
Yeah.
The same thing is obviously happening in music. If you look at the folk song arrangements that were written, say, before 1914 by people like Vaughan Williams, Percy Grainger, and then you listen to Bartok's version of, you know, Hungarian folk songs, it's a completely different musical language.
Absolutely.
And some of the other pieces that we're doing, you know, for instance, the neoclassics, Stravinsky, even Kurt Weill is a nod back to the Beggar's Opera written in 1720 or something. How do you see that working, well, or as a big influence on the way you've programmed?
Yeah, well,
things?
That's exactly the thing. We're actually working when talking about how to contextualize this, because I want people who come into the concert hall to be able to experience the music. Obviously, the moment when we're together there. It's about the music. It's about the creations of these composers. But for me, as a performer, as a conductor, context is incredibly important. And so we've been having discussions about contextualization, and we've been working with an art historian on this because, for example, I think a lot of people are aware of, as you mentioned, Cubism in art, but. As you mentioned, Cubism also exists in music. It's essentially what Stravinsky did in Rite of Spring. He'll take a little musical picture, a little phrase. Let's say it's a face, because, you know, a phrase has an identity. You could say it's a face. But then what he'll do is, in the course of the Rite of Spring, is he'll cut it up, and you'll just see fragments of it, and you'll see it from odd angles, just as Picasso did. And if I might add, both of those individuals were consummate technicians. They, you know, you see Picasso sketches. I mean, he could sketch anything he wanted.
He's a great draftsman.
Exactly. He could have drawn a perfect face. So this is an important thing, I think, for people to realize both in art and in music. These are all always choices that the composer made with a deliberate intent. So to go back to, I think, something I mentioned last time, you know, Shostakovich could always write happy themes if he wanted to. He was incredibly gifted at writing happy themes, the equivalent of just drawing a nice face that you like looking at. But he said, no, that's not what I'm trying to express. I can do that somewhere else, but here I want to do this. And so, you know, the subconscious is aware of these things. Just like when you listen to a Bach fugue, he's doing it in a very different way. He'll give you a theme, and then he'll enter with the same theme in a different key. Your brain will recognize that it's the same tune. But as a counterpoint to that, he'll quite often take the original theme and play with it. You don't realize that, your conscious mind, but your subconscious is kind of massaged. You know, it's like, oh, that's nice, because because everything relates. And in Stravinsky and colleagues, and sometimes they're trying to do exactly the opposite, which is the opposite of a brain massage. They're trying to make you feel awkward and uncomfortable and ask yourself, wait, what do I know? What don't I know? I thought I recognized that phrase, but now it's all cut up and jittery.
It makes you think of the Richard Carr by Webern, for instance. The pointillistic version.
Absolutely.
Of Bach, really.
Yeah, exactly. And these are, the things when I maybe preparing an audience, if it's a video or a podcast together, for some of these programs, that I'd love to just talk about, because it gives pointers. You know, I'm the first person when I hear music I don't know, who quite often leaves a hall saying, "Huh, I didn't really get that." You know, there's some works I get immediately, or I feel like I get immediately. I sort of, yeah, that had an effect on me. That for me transmitted this or this message. But there are other works that don't. And one of the lovely things about my profession is that I often can't just be happy with that. I can't just say, well, I didn't like it. I quite often have to perform these pieces, so I get very into them. And I find the more I understand what a composer was or wasn't trying to achieve with a piece, the more actually both my conscious and my subconscious mind are capable of appreciating it. Now, appreciation doesn't necessarily mean like. Mm-hmm. The appreciation means comprehending, or, you know, in a way, understanding the message that has been trying to be transmitted. And I think that's, there are many books that we read, there are many things that we engage with, films, where it's not necessarily about like or don't like. It's about experiencing something, and something that is in the vast spectrum between those two very simple contexts or ideas.
One thing that sticks out in this particular period is the tremendous influence of politics. Mm. And you mentioned nationalism. Mm. Frequently, composers spend their whole lives living in one place, one country, writing that music. Mm. In this period, we have nomads. We have people like Stravinsky, who left Russia, Prokofiev, who left Russia, Weill, who left Germany, Eisler, who left Germany, then went back afterwards. Yeah. He was twice thrown out, basically. Yeah. He was thrown out of the States because he was a communist.
Yeah.
How do you think this influences the way 20th century music has developed?
Well, greatly. Prokofiev went back to Russia as well. Shostakovich stayed in Russia. I think his music would have been completely different if he'd gone to the States. It's one of those eternal questions of what would have happened if Bach, instead of working for the church all his life, had moved to Dresden, and he'd worked for the emperor there, or the king there.
And gone to Italy and written operas like
Handel. I mean, it could have happened, you know. What would have happened if Shostakovich had moved to the States? Who knows? But I absolutely think that it's very important, both for the individuals, but also for the history of music, as you say. A nice example, because he'll be later there with us later in the season, is Korngold, who we're also performing this week as we're speaking. Is from the German-Austrian school of composition, you know, post-Wagnerian, post-Mahlerian school. He went of free will over to the States to write music for a film, came back, and then sought exile, essentially, in California. And it was the sound of his music, of his orchestration, his conception of how a symphony orchestra works, that, in a sense, defined the way Hollywood sounded in the 40s and the 50s. So, you know, I, growing up watching Robin Hood, which was on kind of around Christmas.
My favorite movie.
I love it. I know. It was one of my favorite movies, too. And, you know, around Christmas, you just start watching all these films. And I remember watching Robin Hood and loving it. But for me, that sound was America. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, wow, that's super, you know, if there's an American sound, it's that sound of like really virtuosic and incredible orchestral writing. But it's a German-Austrian sound.
It's almost operatic, isn't it?
Yeah. And this sort of seeding of different sounds from one continent to another had an extraordinary effect on the general development of music, as did the growth of jazz, and then also the, you know, for our contemporary music, the evolution of jazz into pop music, and the evolution of folk into pop music, and then dance music, and the influences of African music. They've all had very deep, and of course that's not to speak of the influence of Far Eastern music and Indian music. These have also had incredibly important effects. A little bit like if you look at the physiology of people, you know, the number of people whose heritage is very difficult to place when you first see them is greater than it ever has been. It'll continue to go that way. And it's a bit like that with pieces of music. You could try and trace their heritage back. But nowadays, and already in this period we're talking about, it's rooted in so many different cultures, it becomes absolutely fascinating.
You get the same thing with literature as well, of course, all the different styles.
Absolutely.
Could you talk a bit now about what you alluded to earlier, the Dear Life?
Yeah, well, as a welcome gift, when I was announced here as music director designate, the managing director of the orchestra, Christopher Deaton, he gave me a gift, which was the most recent publication by Alice Munro, the Nobel Prize-winning author from Canada, and it's a collection of short stories called Dear Life, which I then went away and read. And this was happening at the same time as conversations were happening here with me talking about how we want to move forward, you know, artistically in creation, about the commissioning of new music, and looking towards the sesquicentennial of Canada 2017, saying, right, what role do we play? What role does music play? What role does the NAC play? And we had conversations like, what does it mean to be Canadian? Unanswerable questions like, what does it mean to be a Brit? Or what does it mean? You know, these are not answerable questions, but the discussion is very interesting. And there are as many points of view as there are people in a room at any given time. But this was happening in that context. I read the book. And the last story, Dear Life, in the series, is autobiographical. And it's a sort of first-person narrative of storytelling of a memory from Alice Munro's youth, the place she grew up, of a lovely, an interesting little story, but a very affecting story, a very beautiful story, and one that felt, and I have to emphasize, this is just feeling in this case, authentically Canadian to someone who isn't Canadian. When I was reading and I thought, huh, we had all these conversations, but this feels to me, it's a small town, and you know, in the wide, grand Canadian landscape, these intimate relationships in community. And I thought this was a very special short story. I enjoyed it very much. And then I came back with the suggestion that for my first concert, we commission a Canadian composer to write a piece of music based on Dear Life. And there's a poem at the end of Dear Life that Alice Munro wrote, and it comes from her childhood, that I thought we could set for a singer, and that we would marry that up in the second half with a very different childhood view, which is the view of heaven from Mahler's Fourth Symphony in the last movement.
Right.
It seemed to me that they were both, in a sense, optimistic and yet retrospective and yet intimate, and they had a relationship to one another. And I like the idea of pairing up Mahler, who's very close to my heart, and I know the orchestra has a wonderful line of the sort of Germanic repertoire running through its history. It would marry up with our shared interest in that line of wonderful line of music, and then a new take on it, deeply entrenched in Canadian culture. And we decided to do that. Everyone was excited by the idea, and we ran with it. So that's going to be the main pairing on my first concert. There'll be a piece by Elgar, in fact, to open the concert, which is another work related to youth. It's called The Wand of Youth.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
He wrote the sketches for that, or he wrote the tunes when he was a boy, and then he orchestrated it later. So I saw between all three works this relationship between a mature individual, and then the voice of youth, each of them looking in a different direction. Now, in our further conversations about the first season, when we were talking about creation and the commissioning of new music, I had several other ideas, and I was also given several wonderful ideas by colleagues here in the artistic staff and by our managing director as well. Food for thought. And to cut a long story short, because it's a long story, we're going to be putting together at the end of the season a multidisciplinary, fully immersive, one-act concert, so no interval, that will have video installation, it'll have possibly dances, it will have text, it will have light effects, that will be concentrated on four works of new music, all Canadian. We have Dear Life, which I've just mentioned. We will have a new work based on a poem which I read when I was doing my research into Canadian culture by Rita Jo called I Lost My Talk, which is about her going to an English-speaking school and essentially losing her identity. That's the metaphor of the poem. We'll be exploring, with the blessing of her mother, because it's an incredibly sensitive issue, but one that I think is very important part of our modern culture, is the tragic and yet somehow empowering story of Amanda Todd, the young lady who was bullied at school and who was stalked on the internet and who tragically found no way out. She committed suicide, but she left this video message where she holds up these cards that she's filled out telling her story, which is an incredibly strong thing for somebody to do. We're having that story also as part of our production. New music will be written to that. My hope with this is firstly to explore strong, interesting women and their narratives through music, but also then through video in the Amanda Todd case, and through text in the case of Dear Life, and to create an evening that for an audience is something completely different. I think it's often challenging to hear new music without context and on a concert stage. You know, it sometimes works, but it doesn't always work.
Absolutely.
And I think the chance of success, the chance of saying, okay, this isn't just a classical concert, you know, as everybody's used to. There's something very different. This is an immersive experience. The stage will look very different, and so on and so forth. This has a point. You know, we're really delving into one very interesting idea and one very important thing, the voice of these four women and what they're all saying in different ways. It's empowering, it's challenging. That will be what Dear Life is, and that will be the culmination of our season. Each of these works will be performed as an entity on its own throughout the season as part of other concerts and in another context, but then we'll put together Dear Life in this immersive, multidisciplinary form.
Complete package.
Yeah.
The final, or at least one of the last concerts of the season, is all Wagner.
Yeah.
Could you explain what's going on there?
Well, there's a sort of... firstly, it's a form of bookend. We have Mahler 4 at the beginning, which is a child's view of heaven. Tristan and Isolde is the emancipation of the soul. At the end of that piece, it's some of the most glorious music ever written. But at the end of that piece, Isolde of free will gives up her soul in order to reach freedom and to be released. Obviously Tristan and Isolde, not obviously, for those who don't know, at the time that Wagner wrote Tristan and Isolde, he was preoccupied and very interested in Schopenhauer and his philosophy. And so the connection between day and night, life and death, also represents the relationship between being sort of chained by reality that we experience and being free from that reality through death or through sleep or through darkness. And so it's a little bookend to the sort of brightness of the Mahler at the beginning and a more innocent view of heaven. We're doing a wonderful version of it. It's all music written by Wagner. Every single note is original from Tristan and Isolde. But Henk de Vlieger, the Dutch arranger, has put together a 65-minute, 70-minute, I think he calls it symphonic passion. It's all the best bits, I think, of Tristan and Isolde in one seamless work that goes through in 60, 65 minutes, starting with the prelude and ending with the Liebestod and then the key music in between. And of course, it is absolutely justifiable doing it like this because Wagner imbued the music of his opera with some of the most meaning. It means a lot. And he works on his main themes in the opera through the music. So it's okay not having the singers, and it's an amazing piece. And in the first half, another good friend of mine, Colin Curry, the percussionist, is going to perform a work which is closely related to Wagner by the American composer Christopher Rouse. It's called Der gerettete Alberich, so Alberich saved. And the premise of the piece is, what happens at the end of the ring? Alberich, kind of the baddie, what happens to his story? Is he alive or dead? And the piece starts fantastically. You hear one-to-one the last few measures of the ring, just as original. Mm-hmm. Then they fade away. And during those measures, the soloist walks on stage, so he's not there at the beginning. Then he walks up to a güiro, which is a South American instrument with a percussion instrument with ruts along the top. It sounds like a washboard.
That's right.
And he draws the stick along the top slowly and then goes back quickly along it. And it creates the effect a bit like Darth Vader of breathing. So it goes like this. And this is the breathing, the heavy breathing of Alberich. And we see him there on stage deciding what to do. And then this breathing speeds up and it goes into this sort of perpetuo moto, running music, and we're off on our trip. And it's in three movements. The last movement is part of Christopher Rouse's style, sort of rocky. The soloist is sitting at a drum set all the way through, and you have very sort of groovy pop-influenced sounds, then going back to Wagnerian sounds. The slow movement, which is beautiful, he uses a lot of the music from the ring, you know, horn calls and so on and so forth. And it's a wonderfully inventive and fantastical journey through what might have happened to this character from the ring, using original parts of the ring, the sounds, but also infused with this very individual language of Christopher Rouse. And again, I hope that people will enjoy this juxtaposition. So we're hearing Tristan and Isolde in the second half, but a fantastical take on a continuation of the ring in the first half.
That's really interesting stuff.
Good.
Now, the whole season, have we left anything out that you want to talk about?
Well, I mentioned Korngold earlier. There's going to be a lovely concert where the wonderful violinist Daniel Hope, a good friend, comes and performs Korngold's Violin Concerto, which we recorded recently together. We will, on that program, also include one of our new pieces for Dear Life, and we'll look at Shostakovich's Ninth Symphony. And the reason I mention this is just so people also get the juxtaposition of these works. Korngold said when he went to the States and sought exile there, he said that until the Nazi regime falls, he won't write another piece of concert music, serious music. And so in the time in between, he just wrote film music. And on the fall of the Nazis, the end of the Second World War, he said, I'm released, and he wrote the Violin Concerto. And it's a beautiful, elegiac and singing work of music. the same time, on the other side of the Atlantic in Russia, Shostakovich had been writing during the war these tragically affecting symphonies, which, like a few other creations in the history of music, expressed the pain of suffering through totalitarianism and war. And then the war ended, and Stalin, who had always been aware of Shostakovich's international star status and his import as a sort of propaganda, said, "Right, now that we're victorious over the Germans, I expect of you a triumphant Ninth Symphony, you know, celebrating the Soviet victory, in the style of Beethoven's Ninth, and so on and so forth." And Shostakovich came back not with this triumphant symphony with chorus and soloists, but with this sarcastic, satirical, snide symphony, you know, which ends with this silly sort of pseudo-heroic thing and then stops and goes into more satire. It's a really sort of tongue-in-cheek work, but seen in context, also a very dangerous thing for him to have done. So that program is interesting because we're juxtaposing two reactions to the end of war. One, free, as you were allowed to be in America, to just be, and the optimism of the future. The other one, very much lacking in optimism, but full of bite and awareness and of you know, the stupidity, essentially, of an individual like Stalin.
Yeah, satire is a very powerful tool in art, isn't it?
Absolutely, absolutely, and it's subversive. And you know, I think stupid may be the wrong word to have used about Stalin, because somebody with that ability to manipulate and to do evil can't be simply stupid. And similarly, he was aware of how powerfully subversive art could be, which is why he was so fearful of it and of Shostakovich. So that's another program which I think is interesting. Plus, I happen to like talking about it, and I talk my teeth off, but it's also just beautiful music. You know?
It's great stuff. Well, we're really looking forward to the season.
Good,
and,
me too.
As things develop, there'll be a few more things announced, I guess, in the next few weeks.
Yeah.
Thanks very much for coming in.
Thank
and I'm
you
sure
for
we'll do
me.
It again. You'll break the record again.
Look forward to it, Nick. Thank you.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca. Or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.